At 6:34 p.m. on the 22nd of June, a modest stone house in Glassboro, New Jersey, suddenly became a permanent part of the world's history books. The White House announced that President Johnson had invited Chairman Kosygin to meet with him at 11 o'clock the next day at the home of the president of Glassboro State College. Chairman Kosygin had accepted. It was no Yalta nor Geneva, but a simple 19th century home near an early American farming settlement. Yet in its own way, a uniquely appropriate setting for the two statesmen who would meet there. Both possessed unimaginable power, yet both were unpretentious, straightforward. Both had sat in the company of kings, yet both understood the language of the farmer and the factory worker. In this simple arena, they would face each other for nearly 10 hours, both becoming, for a brief moment in history, the focal point of a troubled world's hopes and prayers.
Kosygin this morning. We talked throughout the day quietly and straightforwardly with him, and I'm glad to say to you that I've found that he came to our meeting in the same spirit. We talked about the problems of the Middle East in detail, and we shall continue to talk about them. We talked about the problems of Southeast Asia. We've talked about the arms race and about the need for new agreements there. We talked about the need for common action on constructive initiatives for peace. We reached no new agreements, almost but not quite, but new agreements are not always reached in a single conversation, so we're going to eat lunch and spend Sunday together again at Hollybush.
The first day of the summit talks was over, but for the president there was still much work to do. After assuring the thousands of enthusiastic onlookers that the meeting had been a very good and useful one, he bid a momentary goodbye to his historic guest. This was the 25-hour day. He had been on the go since 4:30 in the morning, and he had 5,000 miles and 12 more hours to burn before there would be any rest. It would be difficult to pinpoint any moment in Lyndon Johnson's political career as satisfying as this 23rd day of June 1967. He had fired the imagination of the public with the sudden bold moves that led to the face-to-face encounter at Glassboro. At a $500 a plate dinner for the President's Club of Los Angeles, he was able to announce that financially, the Democratic Party was over the top. The $4 million debt had been paid. And if that wasn't enough good news for one day, he could relish the report he had received only 18 hours earlier. He was a grandfather. It was now Saturday, the 24th of June, in a small room in Austin, Texas.
I would like to help make a world for young Patrick Nugent and his contemporaries in every land that will be safer and will be more prosperous and more hopeful and certainly more peaceful by far than the world that I have inhabited. So working together, reasoning together, planning together, and being patient, understanding, I believe that we can achieve such a world.
On Sunday, the 25th of June, the president returned to Glassboro. This time, he brought the family. On hand to welcome them back were New Jersey's Governor Richard Hughes and Mrs. Hughes, who had been instrumental in making Hollybush available.
Thank you.
Profound differences between the two statesmen still remain, but nothing could dampen the spirit nor the ardor of the day. The premier was accompanied by his daughter Ludmilla, and for the rest of the day, she would be the special guest of Mrs. Johnson and Lynda. As the second day of talks continued, heavy rainstorms lashed the campus, but the thousands who had come to witness history stood their ground. They had talked for more than 4 hours, delving even deeper into the many questions that separated their two countries. At 6:20 in the evening, they had finished.
We have made further progress in an effort to improve our understanding of each other's thinking on a number of questions. I believe more strongly than ever that these have been very good and very useful talks.
Premier Kosygin had been visibly touched by the warmth and enthusiasm exhibited by the people of Glassboro. He personally thanked them and saluted friendship between the Soviet and American people.
These meetings just have not ended our troubles and our dangers, and I cannot promise you that that will not happen again. The world remains a very small and very dangerous, and all nations, even the greatest of them, have very hard and very painful choices ahead of them. What I can tell you, and I have no doubt about it at all, is that it does help a lot to sit down and look a man in the eye all day long and try to reason with him. Particularly if he is trying to reason with you. And that's why we went to Hollybush this morning. And reasoning together there today was the spirit of Hollybush.
On the 27th of June, after a week of exhaustive effort within the framework of foreign affairs, President Johnson turned his energies towards his domestic program. At the Junior Chamber of Commerce annual convention, he spoke out for the things that were right with the country. He praised the doers, the builders. But to the doubters and the cussers, the draft card burners and protesters.
You say to them that it's not absolutely essential. It's not a prerequisite. It's not required that you tear our country down and our flag down in order to lift them up.
The month of June was virtually over. On what one staffer called a good news trip, the president saw partial fruition of his greatest ambition, the continual strengthening of his own people. In Philadelphia, in the heart of an impoverished area, the president visited the Opportunities Industrialization Center. He had heard about the center for months, a community-built school where unemployable residents, instead of resorting to protest and despair, were picking themselves up by their bootstraps and learning a trade.
I saw human beings that had pride in their eyes instead of fear, their shoulders straight and high and their chin up. The federal government did not do this. The federal government did not build this center. What built this center is the spirit that's in the breath of every human that's a part of it. The spirit that wants to say yes to life itself, that wants to affirm the dignity of man, whatever his origins, whatever his race, whatever his religion. So if I had to sum up my feelings in a single phrase this morning, I would say to all of you, I believe we're going to make it.